Hello, dear student. I hope you are in a safety now and ready to listen lecture. And topic for today is gallstone disease, chronic cholecystitis, and functional biliary disorders. So let's start. And some information about bile secretion and composition. Bile formed in the hepatic lobule is secreted into a complex network of canaculi, small bile ducts, and larger bile ducts that run with lymphatic and branch of the portal vein and hepatic artery in portal tract situated between hepatic lobules. These intralobal bile ducts coalesce to form large septal bile duct from join to form the right and left hepatic ducts. The common hepatic duct is joined by the cystic duct of the gallbladder to form the common bile duct, which enters the duodenum through the upper water. Hepatic bile is an isotonic fluid with an electrolyte composition resembling blood plasma. The electrolyte composition of gallbladder bile differs from that of hepatic bile because most of the inorganic anions, chlorate, and bicarbonate have been removed by reabsorption across the gallbladder epithelium. As a result of water reabsorption, total solute concentration of bile increases from 3-4 grams on deciliter in hepatic bile to 10-15 grams on deciliter in gallbladder bile. More solute components of bile by most person include bile acid, lecithin, and traces of other phospholipids, and anti-esterified cholesterol. In the lytogenic state, the cholesterol value can be as high as 8-10%. Other consumptions include conjugated bilirubin, proteins, electrolytes, mucose, and often drugs and their metabolites. The total daily nasal secretion of hepatic bile is 500-600 milliliters. The mechanism are important is regulated by bile flow. First, active transport of bile acids from hepatocytes into the bile canaculi. Second, active transport of other organic anions and cholangiol. And third, cholangiol cellular secretion. The last is a secretin mediated and cyclic APM dependent mechanism that result in the secretion of sodium and bicarbonate rich fluid into the bile ducts. Cholesterol catabolism by hepatocytes result in the synthesis of the two major primary bile acids, Maholic acid and chenodeoxyholic acid. This process involves multiple steps with cholesterol 7-alpha hydrolyzed acting as a rate-limited enzyme. Primary bile acids undergo dehydrolation by bacteria in the small intestine, forming the secondary bile acids, deoxyholic acid and lytoholic acid, respectively. Both primary and secondary bile acids are conjugated by the liver with an amino acid, either lysine or taurine. Conjugated bile acids are known as bile salts. Bile salts inhibit cholesterol 7-alpha hydrolyze, decreasing the synthesis of bile acids. And on this picture, you may see mechanism of bile secretion and composition. The main step in the formation of bile are the uptake on bile acids and joints from plasma across the basolateral membrane, transport through the hepatocyte, and excretion via the canalicular membrane. And more details about basolateral membrane. The sodium-potassium ATPase of the basolateral membrane of the hepatocyte maintains sodium and potassium gradients. Because three sodium ions are expelled from the cell in return for receiving two potassium ions, an electrochemical gradient is formed. The relative negative charge inside the hepatocyte powers the uptake on positively charged ions, while the sodium gradient falls, the sodium-dependent taurohalate cotransporter protein. This transporter allows for the uptake on conjugated bile acids. And more detail about canalicular membrane. The transporter proteins found in the canalicular membrane are primary members of the ATP binding cassette protein family. These proteins use active transport to secrete molecules and enzymes into the bile. The canalicular membrane transporter helps secrete molecules into bile against concentration gradients and also enzymes such as alkaline phosphatase. Contractile microfilaments facilitate the secretion of bile through the canalicular. And on this table, you may see a disease of the gallbladder and description about every disease. For example, what is cholelithiasis? Is microscopic crystals or large stone in the gallbladder. What is cholecystitis? Is inflammation of the gallbladder. What is choledocholithiasis? Is common bile duct stones. What is biliary dyskinesia? Is motility disorder of the gallbladder caused by scarring of spots of the sphincter of Oddi? What is gallbladder perforation? Is a hole or opening in the wall of the gallbladder and maybe acute? Acute is generalized biliary peritonitis. Maybe subacute is acute plus cholecystic abscess and maybe chronic cholecystoenteric fistula. And what is gallstone pancreatitis? Inflammation of the pancreas caused by obstruction of the pancreatic duct by a gallstone. And what is a gallbladder polyps? Is overgrowth or lesions in the gallbladder wall. And what is cholecystitis? Cholecystitis is defined as an inflammation of the gallbladder that occurs most commonly because of an obstruction of the cystic duct from cholelithiasis. 90% of cases involve stones in the gallbladder, with the other 10% of cases representing alkalous cholelithiasis. Cholecystitis. Gallstone disease is very common. About 10-20% of the world population will develop gallstones at some point in their life, and about 80% of them are symptomatic. And cholecystitis may be acute and may be chronic. Some details about acute cholecystitis. Acute inflammation of the gallbladder wall usually follows obstruction of the cystic duct by a stone. Inflammatory response can be evoked by three factors. First, mechanical inflammation produced by increased intraluminal pressure and distension with resulting ischemia of the gallbladder mucosa and wall. Second, chemical inflammation caused by the release of lecithin and other local tissue factor, and third factor, bacterial inflammation, which may play a role in 50-85% of patients with acute cholecystitis. And some details about chronic cholecystitis. Chronic inflammation of the gallbladder wall is almost always associated with the presence of gallstones and is thought to result from repeat bouts of subacute or acute cholecystitis, or from persistent mechanical irritation of the gallbladder wall by gallstones. The presence of bacteria is the bioaccurs in more than 25% of patients with chronic cholecystitis. The presence of infected bile in a patient with chronic cholecystitis undergoing elective cholecystectomy probably adds little to the operative risk. Chronic cholecystitis may be asymptomatic for a year, which may progress to symptomatic gallbladder disease or to acute cholecystitis, or may present with complications. And you may see schematical information for acute and chronic cholecystitis. And some details about etiology. Chronic cholecystitis mostly occurs in the setting of cholecystitis. Proposed etiology is recurrent episodes of acute cholecystitis or chronic irritation from gallstones in walking and inflammatory response in the gallbladder wall. Sometimes the term is used to describe abdominal pain resulting from dysfunction in the emptying of the gallbladder. This overlaps with sphincter body dysfunction and is the best referred to as biliary or gallbladder dyskinesia. Risk factors for cholecystitis include a male gender, obesity, rapid weight loss, pregnancy, advanced age, Hispanic or Pima Indians. And some detail about pathophysiology. Gallstones by causing intermittent obstruction of the bile flow. Most commonly by blocking the cystic duct lead to inflammation and edema in the gallbladder wall. Occlusion of the common bile duct such as a neoplasm or strictures can also lead to stasis of the bile flow causing gallstone formation with resulting chronic cholecystitis. It has been proposed that lithogenic bile leads to increased free radical mediated damage from hydrophobic bile salts. That in association with reduced mucosal protection due to low levels of prostaglandin E2 results in a continuous inflammatory state. When the cholecystokinin receptor of the smooth muscles are affected, there is impaired gallbladder contraction that leads to stasis and worsens the permissive environment where lithogenic bile promotes inflammation. And you may see on this picture variant or type of gallstones. And you may see pigment or calcified gallstones, cholesterol gallstones, and combine both variant of types of gallstones and named mixed gallstones. And continue about pathophysiology and more detail about cholesterol glands, gallstones. More than 18% of gallstones contain cholesterol as their main component. Liver cells secrete cholesterol into bile along with phospholipid in the form of small spherical membranes bubbles termed unia lamella vesicles. Liver cells also secrete bile salts, which are powerful detergent required for the digestion and absorption of dietary fats. Bile cells in bile dissolve the unia lamella vesicle to form soluble aggregates called mixed micelles. This happens mainly in the gallbladder, where bile is concentrated by reabsorption of electrolytes and water. Combined with vesicles, mixed micelles have a lower carrying capacity for cholesterol. If bile contain a relatively high proportion of cholesterol to begin with, then a bile in concentrated progressive dissolution of vesicle may lead to a state in which the cholesterol carrying capacity of the micelles and residual vesicles is exceeded. At this point, bile is supersaturated with cholesterol and cholesterol monohydrate crystals may form. Thus, the main factors that determine whether cholesterol gallstones will form are, first, the amount of cholesterol secreted by liver cells relative to lecithin and bile salts, and second, the degree of concentration and extent of stasis of bile in the gallbladder. Next variant of gallstone, calcium bilirubin and pigment. Bilirubin, a yellow pigment derived from the breakdown of heme, is actively secreted in bile by liver cells. Most of the bilirubin in bile is in the form of glucocorticoid conjugates, which are water-soluble and stable, but a small proportion consists of unconjugated bilirubin. Unconjugated bilirubin, like fatty acids, phosphatate, carbonate, and other anions, tends to form insoluble precipitates with calcium. Calcium enters bile passively along with other electrolytes. In situation of higher heme turnover, such as chronic hemolysis or cirrhosis, unconjugated bilirubin may be present in bile and higher than normal concentrations. Calcium bilirubinate may then crystallize from the solution and eventually form stones. Over time, various oxidation causes the bilirubin precipitates to take on a jet black color, and stones form in this manner are termed black pigment gallstones. Black pigment stones represent 10-20% of gallstones. Bile is normally sterile, but in some unusual circumstances, it may become colonized with bacteria. The bacteria hydrolyze conjugated bilirubin, and then resulting increase in unconjugated bilirubin may lead to precipitation of calcium bilirubinate crystals. Bacteria also hydrolyze lecithin to release fatty acids, which also may bind calcium and precipitate from the solution. The resulting concretion have a clay-like consistency and the term brown pigment stones. Unlike cholesterol or black pigment gallstones, which form almost exclusively in the gallbladder, brown pigment gallstones often form the novel and the bile ducts. Brown pigment gallstones are unusual in the United States, but are fairly common in some part of the Southeast Asia, possibly related to liver fluke infestation. And next variant of gallstone, mixed. Cholesterol gallstones may become colonized with bacteria and and can elicit gallbladder, mucosal inflammation. Cystic enzymes from the bacteria and leukocytes are hydrolyzed bilirubin conjugates and fatty acids. As a result, over time, cholesterol stones may accumulate a substantial proportion of calcium bilirubinate and other calcium salt-producing mixed gallstone. Large stone may develop a surface rim of calcium resembling an eggshell that may be visible of plain X-ray film. Symptomatic patient with chronic cholecystitis usually present with dual right upper abdominal pain that radiates around the waist to the mid-back or right scapular trip. The pain may be exacerbated by fatty food intake, but the classical postprandial pain or acute cholecystitis is less common. Nausea and occasional vomiting also accompany complaints of increased bloating and flatulence. Often the symptoms occur in the evening or at night. Symptoms are usually present over weeks to months as opposed to the abrupt severe presentation or acute cholecystitis. There might be a gradual worsening of symptoms or an increase in the frequency of episodes. Fever and tachycardia are rare. Older patients with cholecystitis may present with lack of symptoms and they are at risk of progression to complicated disease. Hence, a high index of clinical suspicion is required in the diagnosis of this condition. Gallstone disease may be through or as having the following four stages. The lytogenic stage in which conditions for gallstone formation. Asymptomatic gallstones. Symptomatic gallstones characterized by episodes of biliary colic and complicated cholelithiasis. Symptoms and complications of gallstone disease result from effects occurring within the gallbladder or from stones that escape the gallbladder to lodge in the common bile duct. Asymptomatic gallstones. Gallstones may be present in the gallbladder for decades without causing symptoms or complication. In patients with asymptomatic gallstones discovered incidentally, the high likelihood of developing symptoms or complication in 1-2% per year. In most cases, asymptomatic gallstones do not require any treatment. And information about biliary colic. Pain term biliary colic occurs when gallstone or sludge fortitulant impairs the cystic duct during a gallbladder contraction, increasing gallbladder wall tension. In most cases, the pain resolves over 30 to 90 minutes as the gallbladder relaxes and the obstruction is relieved. Episodes of biliary colic are sporadic and unpredictable. The patient localizes the pain to the epigastrium or right upper quadrant and may describe radiation to the right scapular tip. The pain begins postprandially, is often described as intense and dull, and may last from 1-5 hours. From onset, the pain increases steadily over about 10 to 20 minutes and then gradually wanes when the gallbladder stops contracting and the stone falls back into the gallbladder. The pain is constant in nature, is not relieved by emesis, antacids, defecation, virtus or positional changes. It may be accompanied by diaphoresis, nausea, and vomiting. All the symptoms often associated with cholelithiasis include indigestion, dyspepsia, belching, bloating, and fat intolerance. However, these are very non-specific and occur in similar frequencies in individuals with and without gallstones. Cholecystectomy has not been shown to improve these symptoms. And distinguishing uncomplicated biliary colic from acute cholecystitis or other complication is important. Key findings that may be noted include the following. Uncomplicated biliary colic, pain that is poorly localized and visceral, as essentially benign abdominal examination without rebound or guarding, absence of fever. Next, acute cholecystitis. Well-localized pain in the right upper quadrant, usually with rebound and guarding. Positive morphine, frequent presence of fever, absence of peritoneal signs, frequent presence of tachycardia and diaphoresis. In severe cases, absence of hypoactive bile sounds. And some information about examination and instrumental method. Used primary to exclude other causes of abdominal pain. Black pigment or mixed gallstones may contain sufficient calcium to appear radiopaque on plain films. The finding of air in the bile duct or plain film may indicate development of a cholecystitic fistula or ascending cholangitis with gas-forming organism. Calcification in the gallbladder wall is indicative of severe chronic cholecystitis. The main role of plain film in evaluating patients with suspected gallstone disease is to include other causes of acute abdominal pain, such as intestinal obstruction, visceral perforation, renal stones, or chronic calcific pancreatitis. Next method of examination, cholecystography. And following symptoms are characterized for patients with chronic cholecystitis. Absence of gallbladder shadow, derangements of concentration ability and motility of gallbladder, deformation of gallbladder wall. Next method is ultrasonography. The procedure of choice is suspected gallbladder disease. In the more sensitive, specific, non-invasive, and inexpensive test for the detection of gallstones, it is highly sensitive and specific for gallstones greater than 2 mm. It is less for microlithiasis of biliary sludge. Ultrasonography is very useful for diagnosing uncomplicated acute cholecystitis. The sonographic feature of acute cholecystitis include gallbladder wall thickening more than 5 mm, pericholecystic fluid, gallbladder distension more than 5 cm, and sonographic morphine. The presence of multiple criteria increases its diagnostic accuracy. Endoscopic ultrasonography and accurate and relative non-invasive means of identifying stones in the distal common bile duct. Ultrasonographic criteria of information in gallbladder. thickness of wall of gallbladder more than 4 millimeters. In the absence of liver and kidney pathology and congestive heart failure. Increase of gallbladder size of 5 millimeters above the normal for the corresponding age. Presence of sonographic Murphy sign. Presence of parasitic hypoechogenic lymphs. Next method is CT imaging, computed tomography. More expensive and less sensitive than ultrasonography for detecting gallbladder stones, but superior for demonstrated stones in the distal common bile duct. Magnetic resonance imaging with magnetic resonance angiopancreatography, usually reserved for cases in which cholecystitis is suspected. Scintigraphy, highly accurate for the diagnosis of cystic duct obstruction. Next method, endoscopic retrograde angiopathography. And on the picture right, but you may see how provide this these methods. And next about differential diagnosis and what disease similar on chronic cholecystitis. And for example, acute cholecystitis, first disease which is similar on chronic cholecystitis is acute cholecystitis. So, but the main difference between these diseases is pain. Yeah, for acute cholecystitis characterized acute pain and biliary colic, biliary colic. And for chronic cholecystitis, less intensive pain than acute. And next disease, similar on chronic cholecystitis, gallbladder cancer, peptic ulcer disease, gastric cancer, gastroesophageal reflux disease, mesenteric ischemia, mesenteric vasculitis, and myocardial infarction. And next part, treatment. A lot of drugs used in patients with chronic cholecystitis, but main you may see on this slide, yeah? So, continue. And what used? Antibiotics. Indication for antibiotics therapy, presence of clinical or laboratory inflammation, positive results of bioculture and cholangitis. And what use? Ciprofloxacin, 500 mg, 2 day per dose, course 5 days. Cefotaxime, 1 gram, 2 a day intramuscular. Doxycycline, 100 mg, 2 a day per dose, course 5 days. Amoxicillin, 5 mg, 3-4 a day. Tinidazole, 4 pills per dose once. Next part of treatment, symptomatic therapy. And what use? Prokinetic agents, for example, domperidone, 10 mg, or etoprid, 50 mg, 3 days, 30 minutes, prior to meals. spasmolytics, for example, maybe purine 200 to a day, a course 3-4 weeks, drotaverine 40 milligrams 3 a day before meals, papaverine hydrochloride. 2 prosens, 2 milliliter intramuscular. Next, bile-expelling medication. For example, preparations that stimulate cholepoietic function of liver. Preparation of bile acids, synthetic preparations, preparation of herbal origin, preparation that improves secretion of bile by increasing of its aqueous component, and preparations that stimulate biliary excretion. And for example, cholekinetics, cholespasmolytics. Next group of symptomatic therapy, also desoxycholic acid. And next, herbal protector with bile expelling properties. This treatment used for phase of exacerbation, but chronic cholangitis, cholecystitis, have a phase of remission, and treatment during this phase have diet, meals 5-6 times a day, exclude fatty, fried, spicy, smoked food, pickles, alcohol, phytotherapy, mineral water, physiotherapy, and exercise therapy. Treatment of asymptomatic gallstones. Cholecystectomy for asymptomatic gallstones may be indicated in the following patient. Patient with large gallstones greater than 2 cm in diameter. Patient with non-functional or calcified gallbladder observed on imaging studies and who are high risk of gallbladder carcinoma. Patient with spinal cord injuries or sensory neuropathies affecting the abdomen. Patient with sickle cell anemia in whom the distinction between painful crisis and cholecystitis may be difficult. Patient with risk factor for complication of gallstone may be offered elective cholecystectomy. When they have asymptomatic gallstones, this group includes persons with the following condition and demographics: cirrhosis, portal hypertension, children, transplantant candidates, diabetes with minor symptoms. And some information about medical dissolution of gallstones. In patient with established cholesterol gallstone, treatment with oral desoxycholic acid therapy and used 8-10 milligram on kilogram a day per os divided bit or teat may result in gradual gallstone dissolution. This intervention typically requires 6-18 months and is successful only with small poorly cholesterol stones. Patient remains at risk for gallstone complication until dissolution is completed. The recurrence rate is 50% within 5 years. Moreover, after discontinuation of treatment, most patients form new gallstones and subsequent 5-10 years. And treatment of patient with symptomatic gallstones. In patient with symptomatic gallstones, discuss the option for surgical intervention. Surgical interventions to be considered include the following: cholecystectomy, cholecystostomy, endoscopic sphincterostomy. An oral bile acid used for the dissolution of gallstones include chenodeoxycholic acid and ursodeoxycholic acid. And chenodiol and ursodiol, respectively. Oral bile acids are most effective for small gallstones and may take up to 24 months to clear the stones. Ursodiol is the most commonly used oral bile acid secondary to its safe side effect profile compared with chenodiol. Chenodiol is associated with dose-dependent diarrhea as well as hepatotoxicity, hypercholesterolemia, leukopenia, and all which limit its use. And on this table, you may see these drugs, ursodiol and chenodiol, and their dosage, their therapy duration, and adverse or bad effects. Next part of this lecture, cholelithiasis. Cholelithiasis is a presence of stones within the common bile duct. It is estimated that common bile duct stones are present in anywhere from 150% of patients with cholelithiasis. Cholelithiasis occurs as a result of the formation of stones in the common bile duct or the passage of gallstones that are formed in the gallbladder in the common bile duct. Bile stasis, bacterial bilia, chemical imbalances, increased bilirubin excretion, pH imbalances, and the formation of sludge are some of the factors which lead to the formation of the stones. Less commonly, stones are formed in the intrahepatic biliary tree, term primary hepatolithiasis, and may lead to cholelithiasis. Stones that are too large to pass through the ampulla of water remain in the distal common bile duct, causing obstructive jaundice that may lead to pancreatitis, hepatitis, or cholangitis. Primary calculi arise in the nova and the duct are usually brown pigment stones developing if patient with first hepatobiliary parasitism or chronic recurrent cholangitis. Second, congenital anomalies of the bile duct. Third, dilated sclerosed or stricture duct. Or fourth, an MRI for ABCB4 gene defect leading to impaired biliary phospholipid secretion. Common duct stones may remain asymptomatic for year, may pass spontaneously into the duodenum, or may present biliary colic or a complication. Cholelithiasis is more common in female patients, pregnant patients, older patients, and those with high lipid level. Cholesterol stones are typically found in obese patients with low physical activity. Black pigment stones are found in patients with cirrhosis, patients receiving total parenteral nutrition, and those who have undergone an ileal resection. Nucleating factors such as bacteria are a source of the brown pigment primary common bile duct stones. Bile made in the liver and stored in the gallbladder can lead to gallstone formation. In some patients with gallstones, the stones will pass from the gallbladder into the cystic duct and then into the common bile duct. Most of the cholelithiasis causes are secondary to the gallstone passage from the gallbladder in the common bile duct. Primary cholecystitis, which is a formation of stones within the common bile duct, is seen less commonly. Primary cholecystitis occurs in the setting of the bile stasis, which results in intraductal stone formation. The size of the bile duct increases with age. Older adults with dilated bile ducts and biliary diverticula are at risk for the formation of primary bile duct stones. Less secretion, common source of cholelithiasis include complicated Mirisi syndrome of hepatolithiasis. Bile flow is obstructed by stones within the common bile duct, which lead to obstructive jaundice and possibly hepatitis. The stagnant bile can also lead to bacterial bilia and ascending cholangitis. Cholangitis and sepsis are more common in patients with cholecystitis than other sources of bile duct obstruction because a bacterial biofilm typically covers common bile duct stones. The pancreatic duct joins the common bile duct near the duodenum, and therefore the pancreas may also become inflamed by obstruction of pancreatic enzymes. Doctor should examine the patient with particular attention to the general appearances, skin, vital signs, and abdomen. Tenderness is noted in the right upper quadrant of the abdomen. Systemic signs such as fever, hypertension, and flushed skin is present is indicated for infection or sepsis. Or was this seen in the presence of palpable gallbladder of the axon and is seen when the gallbladder dilatation develops due to the obstruction of the common bile duct. The pain is colicky, located in the right upper quadrant of the abdomen and moderate in severity. The pain is intermittent and recurrent. Of patient with endos and history of episodes of epigastric right upper quadrant pain or epigastric pain. A thorough review of this view relief that the patient have been noticed a yellowing of these eyes or skin, experienced pruritus and possibly nausea or vomiting. Jaundice occurs when the stones obstruct the common bile duct and conjugated bilirubin enters the bloodstream. A history including clay colored stools and urine turning tea colored in found in such patient. Jaundice can occur in episodes. A patient with cholangitis also may have a fever, chills, possibly alterate mental status. Gallstones are responsible for approximately half of all causes of pancreatitis. Pancreatitis is precipitated when common bile duct obstruction is the level of the ampulla of water. Pancreatic pain is located in the epigastric and mild abdominal areas and in continuous and radiated to the back. Nausea and vomiting are also present. Some patients have intermittent pain, which results due to transient blockage within the common bile duct. Doctors should order a white blood cells count, hematoglobin, hematocrit, platelets count, total bilirubin, direct bilirubin, alkaline phosphatase, aspartate aminotransferase, and alkaline aminotransferase. Except those esophagus, doctor provide transabdominal ultrasound, and ultrasound is the first test that should be ordered to the patient suspected of any biliary disease, including choledochor lichiasis. After this, doctor may provide transabdominal ultrasound or MRI. Also, diagnostic endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography is more sensitive. It is not longer routinely performed, given the approximately 10% risk for the post-procedural pancreatitis. A transabdominal ultrasound is the first test that should be ordered for the patient suspected of any biliary diseases, including choledochor lichiasis. And the most key causes, abdominal ultrasound will show dilated common bile duct more than 6 mm, and stone within the common bile duct. The detection of common bile duct stones is typically impeded by the presence of gas in the duodenum, but ultrasound can identify common bile duct dilatation accurately with up to 90% accuracy. The treatment for choledochor lichiasis is the removal of the obstructing stones via endoscopic means. At endoscopic retrograde, cholangiopancreatography can be performed under general anesthesia with the patient in either prone or left lateral or supine position. Through prone is the most common position used. The endoscopic will then place a duodenoscope into the second portion of the duodenum and advance a catheter and guide wire into the common bile duct. Sphincterotome then is used to cut the papilla using cautery and enlarge the papilla of water. Often stones will be released with this maneuver. A balloon catheter also can be used to sieve the common bile duct to remove any stones. The endoscopist also can place a stent in the common bile duct, which will serve two purposes. First, any remaining stones will be softened and potentially easy to remove with a secondary cholangiopancreatography. Second, stent will allow a bile drainage to occur, preventing obstructive jaundice. In the stone, a large stalk or there are many stones within the biliary tree, surgical removal is indicated. There are no medications that cure choledochor lichiasis. However, one-time dose of 50 mg to 100 mg rectal indomethacin can be used to prevent postprandial post-procedural pancreatitis. If the pancreatic duct was manipulated during an ARCP. And some information about functional biliary disorders. What is biliary dyskinesia? Biliary dyskinesia is a symptomatic functional disorder of the gallbladder whose precise etiology is unknown. It may be due to metabolic disorders that affect the motility of the gastrointestinal tract, including the gallbladder, or to a primary alteration in the motility of the gallbladder itself. Biliary dyskinesia presents with a symptom complex that is similar to those with a biliary colic. What are the symptoms? Biliary dyskinesia presents with a symptom complex that is similar to those with biliary colic. It is also right upper quadrant pain, severe pain that limits activities of daily living, nausea, associated with episodes of pain. How diagnosed? In order to diagnose biliary dyskinesia, the patient should have right upper quadrant pain similar to biliary colic, but have a normal ultrasound examination of the bladder. For patients who are suspected to have biliary dyskinesia, the wrong diagnostic criteria for functional gallbladder disorder should be considered. This includes pain episodes that last longer than 30 minutes, recurrent symptoms that occur in variable intervals, pain that is severe enough to interrupt daily activity, pain that builds up to steady level, pain that is not relieved by bowel movements, postural stage change, and antacids. Exclusion of other structural diseases that should explain the symptoms. Other supportive criteria include associative of pain with nausea and vomiting, radiation of the pain to the infrascapular region, and pain that wakes the patient in the middle of the night, normal liver and the mice, conjugated bilirubin, amylase, and the base. Where and how should high AD scan be obtained? If patient meets this criteria and has a normal ultrasound examination, hepatobiliary immunodiastatic acid scan should be considered. Recently updated criteria for the performance of hepatobiliary scintigraphy should be followed to determine the gallbladder ejection fraction. This guidelines recommends imaging and cholecystokinin octapeptide infusion and a slow and constant rate over 60 minutes. And hepatobiliary immunodiastatic acid scan is an imaging procedure used to diagnose problem in the liver, gallbladder, and bile duct, also known as cholecystography and hepatobiliary scintigraphy. Who should have a cholecystectomy? Patients who have episodes of biliary type right upper quadrant pain without structural abnormalities by ultrasound and abnormal hepatobiliary immunodiastatic acid scan should be considered for cholecystectomy. An abnormal ejection fraction is considered to be less than 38% when the test is administered according to the guidelines described above. Some authors and experts recommended that the symptoms complex should also be a sufficient duration before considering cholecystectomy. So, thank for your attention, and I hope you have interest for this lecture, and see you again on next week. Good luck, dear student.